All right, good evening, or afternoon. Thank you all for coming. It's really great to see such a nice crowd. My name is Rob Phillips, and I am the interim director of Jewish Studies here at Ball State. And we have a program this afternoon that Galit put together called Hava Megillah, the Elements of Jewish Music. So I'm going to just introduce briefly the people that will be performing today. We have, first of all, we have Max Becker, who is our vocalist. He's a sophomore musical theater major here at Ball State. His voice teacher is currently Elizabeth Truitt, who teaches in the School of Music and Theater. We have our cellist, David Rezits. He's a cellist with the Fort Wayne Philharmonic since 1991. He was previously principal cello with the Haifa Symphony in Israel, the assistant principal cello with the Florida Orchestra, and associate principal cello with the Rio de Janeiro Symphony. Dr. Galit Gertsenzon is our piano player for today. She's an internationally recognized pianist and music educator, managing a busy career as a solo and collaborative pianist, piano instructor, and an advocate for performance and research of music and musicians associated with the Holocaust. Born and raised in Israel, she holds a doctor in musical arts in piano performance from the University of Cincinnati College Conservatory of Music. She also holds masters in piano performance and bachelor's in piano performance and musicology, both from the Buchman Mehta School of Music at Tel Aviv University. So thank you in advance for so generously sharing your time and your talent. I would also like to thank the Dean's Office at the College of Sciences and Humanities for their support of the Jewish Studies program. It means a lot to the Jewish community here on campus, as well as the wider Muncie community. Thanks as well to Hahn Hall and Sirsa Hall and the School of Music, as well as the Honors College. The biggest thanks this afternoon goes to the Bessie and Benjamin Ziegler Fund for very generously supporting Jewish Studies at Ball State. So without further ado, to our program.
Good evening. The talk and performance today present three sets of musical compositions that I'm going to perform here with Max and David. I argue that all these three sets share a similar cultural DNA. First, we're going to present classical music with Jewish background. Next, we are going to perform songs from the Shtetl. The Shtetl, this was one name to describe the Jewish small towns in Eastern Europe, which are resembled in such plays or movies such as Fiddler on the Roof. So if you've watched any of the Fiddler on the Roof movie or plays, you know what was the Shtetl. The presentation will culminate with a selection of Klezmer pieces. And within these musical expressions, when I refer to the elements of Jewish music, I refer to the following: the Jewish prayer, secular Jewish texts, modes. These are what in the classical world we call them the scale. And I'm also referring to the Yiddish language, the Shtetl as the center of the Jewish culture in Eastern Europe before the Second World War. To demonstrate these fundamental segments in Jewish music, I will perform with my colleagues here. We have spent several weeks preparing this presentation for you. And all together, we're trying to show you a melting pot, a glimpse to a rich world of Jewish music and culture that spans through centuries and diverse geographical regions. I would also like to note that the program that you're hearing tonight, this collection of pieces, is only a glimpse. It's only a partial demonstration of a much richer and diverse musical world that also includes North African countries and Spain, where Jewish communities flourished for centuries as well. So for the first segment of this presentation, we are going to perform two compositions by Ernest Bloch and James Simon. These are two composers who were born at the same year, 1880, and due to to the events unfolding in Europe at the dawn of the 20th century, had completely different paths of life and death. Ernest Bloch was born in Geneva, Switzerland. He studied in Brussels, Belgium, Germany, and Paris, and eventually immigrated to the United States in 1916 and became an American citizen in 1924. I assume that had he stayed in Europe, he would have likely been murdered like millions of other Jews. By immigrating to the United States and influencing the musical community here from the early 20s, Bloch's music and teaching changed how 20th century music in the US unfolded. Bloch is considered one of the most fruitful and innovative composers of his era, and some of the best 20th century composers studied with and were influenced by his music. Bloch titled many of his compositions with Hebrew titles, including his largest masterpiece, Sacred Service, also known as Avodat HaKodesh. It is a piece that many compare to the Requiem by Mozart, for example. Bloch was the first and perhaps the last composer who created a classical composition that can be used for a Jewish service in its entirety. Other works also drawing on the Jewish heritage include Shlomo, Baal Shem, From Jewish Life, Sweet Ibraik, and more. From Jewish Life, which he composed in 1924, includes three movements titled Prayer, Supplication, and Jewish Song. Bloch indicated that in this piece he only wanted to capture the Jewish spirit and soul. However, those of you who are familiar with Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur services will likely recognize the melody that threads throughout the piece that we are about to play. So the melody... Ashkenazi tradition and both on Yom Kippur and Rosh Hashanah services in the Sephardic communities. The theme that I just played for you is that of a more climactic part in the prayer, and I'm not a cantor, but from the cantor that sings at our synagogue, I always remember Avinu Malkeinu. So this is the melody that Bloch incorporates in this movement. Avinu Malkeinu is one of the oldest Jewish prayers being mentioned as early as in the Talmud. The Talmud is the rabbinic text of the early Judaism that describes essentially all aspects of Jewish life and still taught today to those who are going to be rabbis. Although Bloch intended to only bring the Jewish spirit into such composition, he actually implemented a strong melody from one of the most meaningful prayers in the Jewish religion, creating a classical composition that derives from the Jewish prayer. In his article, The Jewishness of Bloch, Subconscious or Conscious, Alexander Knapp argues that Bloch's early compositions, such as the piece we are performing soon from Jewish Life, and especially the movement prayer, heavily rely on Jewish prayer modes, fixed chants, and Hasidic melodies. Quote, many of his works, as can be seen from the Hebrew-inspired titles, also draw heavily on his Jewish heritage, end quote. And now to composer James Simon. While Bloch found refuge in the United States, James Simon, a Berlin-born Jewish pianist and composer, refused to escape Europe, and during the war spent most of his time in the Netherlands. He was so very drawn to Europe and to European cultural values that even a visit to Israel, which back then was called Palestina, in 1938 to join his family in commemoration of the death of his sister there, did not stop him from returning to the Netherlands that same year. Upon his return, he continued teaching and working until April 1944, And until April 1944, when he was sent to Camp Westerbork and later deported to Terezin, where he quickly became musically active as well. He was murdered in the gas chambers in Auschwitz, October 1944, as many other composers. Although these two composers could not have more disparate connection, the connection that I find in both pieces by Simon and Bloch lays in both composers using musical elements that derive from sacred Jewish music and embedded in each of these pieces. While Bloch embedded the Ashkenazi prayer melody into his composition, Simon incorporated a Jewish Yemenite prayer melody into his Lament for cello and piano. This instrumentalized Lament remains currently his most memorable composition from that very sad visit to Israel. He wrote it in memory of the sister who died, but also alludes to the death of his son who died a while earlier. Simon indicated that this Lament was written in Yemenite style as he heard it in Israel in 1938. The characteristics of that singing and praying style, as Simon may have heard it, feature what a lot of Mizrahim are those that are considered immigrated from North African countries, such as Morocco, Yemen, Libya, Syria, Egypt. And this is called silsulim, and in English it means frills or even curls, if you will. And the style that they frequently use it in their prayer. So I'm not going to try and sing it, but I will just give you an example. So they use a certain technique in their voice that, unfortunately, as a European descendant, I don't have it. So I will not try it now. So we are going to perform these two pieces for you, and then we'll continue after that. So thank you to David Rezits for being here.
Thank you.
pieces we will perform for you today are songs in Yiddish, written and composed by Max Becker and Mordechai Gebirtig. Both are Eastern European singer-songwriters who wrote lyrics in mostly minor key musical setting that described with great nostalgia their lives in the Shtetl. I'd like to discuss the background and significance of the Yiddish language. The Yiddish was spoken in Eastern European countries among the Jewish diaspora and later spread to Israel, United States, and other countries with large Jewish communities. It traces as early as the 12th century, deriving from medieval German and believed to have derived from the Rhineland, as indicated in Julian Rowland's Klezmer piano collection. Yiddish language, as I remember in my own home, combines Hebrew, German, Russian, and other Slavic languages all melted together into one language. Yiddish is spoken today, as far as I know, only among Jewish Orthodox communities in New York, Jerusalem, and others. In previous centuries, Jews around the world, including those who immigrated from Eastern Europe to the United States and Israel, and even those who survived the war and remained in their countries, saw Yiddish as a primitive, degenerate language that they wanted to abandon in favor of modernism. Personally, however, my family, that had very deep roots in Shtetl called Uriv, or Chay today, it's a town that still exists, but had large Jewish communities within. And although my family immigrated from Moldova to Israel in 1975, Yiddish was always spoken in my home as I was growing up. When my grandparents passed away, we no longer spoke Yiddish at home. Back in Eastern European countries, the Shtetl was the heartbeat of Jewish culture, and the Yiddish language flourished in literature, theater, and movies. Here I would like to refer to the texts that capture almost as a time capsule a way of life that no longer exists. Oifen Pripetchik, On the Wooden Stove, by Mark Warshavski. In this song, you have the text in your handouts, but I want to just emphasize on a few things that are very common within Yiddish culture. The rabbi is the teacher, the educator of the young children, and he urges them to remember the Hebrew alphabet. He encouraged them to study the Torah and says, "What else do we need? When you grow older, you will understand how many tears lie in these letters and how much crying. When you carry the exile in torture, you will gain strength from these letters." This song derived from centuries of violent attacks against Jews, which were led by various Tsars in Russia. It unfortunately also predicted the events of the Holocaust. The value of the Torah study in the cheder. The cheder was literally a small room where all the children went every day to study. And they called it a school. The Jewish education was considered by the older Jewish people to be very important. The older rabbi in this song does not see the value of university education greater than Jewish education. In Reisele, Mordechai Gebirtig depicted a love song sang by a young man who is absolutely crazy about this woman. He's so in love with her that he says, "I love you so much, Rezele. I love your house and I love the street. I even love your mother." How many men ever say to a woman, let alone a woman with a Jewish mother, "I love your mother"? The young man keeps whistling to his love every day. And she tells him, "Please don't whistle, I'll be there, just wait around." But then one of the verses, she says, "David, my mom is very Orthodox. She says that whistling isn't a Jewish thing. Please, just call me in Yiddish. Ain't, it's very dry." What the song doesn't tell is that some Jewish households believe that whistling in the house will cause them to lose money or lose their job or just bad luck, so no whistling in the house. No whistling before whistling before school, no singing before going to school because that's bad luck, bad grades. So all kinds of superstitions that I will have to come back to do a talk just about this. In the song titled Moishele, Gebirtig recalls his old friend with which he went to the cheder as children. He keeps saying, "Oi, these were such good times. We were all young. We studied together in the cheder. We played. The rabbi was standing with a stick ready to beat us up. These were such good times. We were so happy. I miss it so much. Of course, today it could not happen. But something that has to do with the Yiddish culture is that crying and laughing all come together, and there's just part of the everyday life. So beating up, it was a sweet memory for him, being beaten up by the rabbi. Mordechai Gebirtig lived most of his life in Krakow, which was is a town in Poland, and was murdered in the Krakow ghetto during its liquidation. His songs express Jewish nostalgia, love, and humility. His melodies, as well as texts, reflect those lost memories of the Jewish shtetl before its destruction during the Holocaust. And I just want to note that in my conversations with Robert several months ago, he mentioned something in the light of, would you please just don't speak so much about the Holocaust. I'm sure you can do something about Jewish music that has nothing to do with the Holocaust. Like Klezmer music, for example. And as I was researching what to share with you tonight, I realized that some of these communities are no longer existing. The shtetl is no longer there. The towns like Krakow or Chay, they're there. But the Jewish people are no longer there. And this is largely because of the Holocaust and because after the war they all fled and immigrated to Israel, to other countries, the United States. So we are going to perform these songs by Warshavski and Gebirtig today, and I'm happy to have Max Becker come here and sing with us. He's also the cantor at our synagogue, and I cannot be happier to do this with him. So thank you, Max.
Ich sich arru, ich gib a pfeif und
Clarinet, drums, violin, and other instrumental varieties, accordion, for example. The styles in which the three pieces are played are Hasidic style and Hora style. Tonight, I will only refer to the Hasidic style, but in the future, I promise to come back and also talk about the Hora style. I also have an emeritus dance professor here, so I avoid saying anything about Hora, which I know he knows much, much better and danced it for many, many years. The Hasidic style originated in the courtyards of rabbis who had large congregations. These were and still are rabbis that function not only as the teacher that we saw, that we heard in Gebirtig and Warshavski songs, but powerful leaders of an entire community. In those communities, music played a very, and still plays a very important role. While music is not allowed in the Orthodox synagogue and women are not allowed to sing in public for men, the instrumental music became an important role for expression, and the nigun is the Jewish chant, became another way for worshiping that the rabbis encouraged. And some of the rabbis were famous for inventing their own nigunim. The first piece that I will be playing is titled Mayufus, depends who says it. Mayufus, but also known as Tanz Yiddelech, which means dance Jews. The title originated in the poetic Old Testament collection, the Song of Songs, Shir HaShirim. The Hasidic style of this piece featured dance in medium tempo, four beats with strong emphasis on the beats one and beat three. And to give you an example, it sounds something like that. The mode of the song is E Ahava Rabba, which means E great love. And it sounds like that. The second piece is titled The Dance of the Rabbi from Trisk. The style, again, is Hasidic style, and the mode has another Hebrew name, Magen Avot. Magen Avot translated to Shield of Our Fathers. It is a mode that takes its name from a paragraph in one of the seven blessings in the Friday evening service. Musically, it most closely resembles a minor scale or the Arabic Makam Nahawant. And I will finish with Hava Nagila, Let Us Rejoice, an Israeli song widely known here in the United States as the most popular wedding song in the Jewish wedding. When I got married with my husband about 10 years ago, we had our wedding celebration in Israel, and he was certain that when once the chuppah is finished, we will all start dancing to the music of Hava Nagila. But in fact, in Israel, we do things a bit differently. And as we were going down the bima is a sort of a stage like this, we were going down from the bima, the rabbi was next to us, and the music started playing very, very loud. And we had about 200 guests, and everybody started dancing. The music was not Hava Nagila. It was Tom Jones's song "Sex Bomb," and I think this is the one thing that he remembers ever since. Hava Nagila's melody too is based on a Hasidic nigun, although it came to its popularity after it was composed in 1915 in the Ottoman Palestine, as Hebrew was reviving and becoming a spoken language after centuries of abandonment. Later, Hava Nagila became a worldwide known song recognized with the Jewish people. And I will now play these three pieces. together with Max, I found this music for a very popular song in the US around, I think it was in the 50s, by me, best to shame. So, does anyone know where was this song originated? Bamir Bistushain. So, a lot of you have heard it, but it's actually, it was very popular, I think in the 50s, sang by the Andrews sisters. And originally, it was written for a Yiddish theater production. So, Max is going to sing this for you. And that's it, I don't have more, but I can play the same Papa again.
My heart grew so light, dear, this old world seemed new to me. You're really swell, and I have to admit you deserve expressions that truly will fit you. And so I've racked my brain, hoping to explain all the things you do to me.
Your girl.